Welcome back to my channel, Dentistry Made Easy. So yesterday in my last video, as I said that I'm going to post videos every day so that you can study well and even you can score good marks. So my topic for today is Introduction to Orthodontics. Hope you have watched my yesterday's video, that was gingival recession, and if you haven't, then I'm linking it below in the description. So moving on towards our topic, that is Introduction to Orthodontics. As everyone knows, like people are saying they are getting their ortho treatment done. So what does that mean? It just means that they are getting those braces on. So in this video, I'm going to give introduction to like what is the definition of orthodontics, then what are the unfavorable consequences of malocclusion. Now what is malocclusion? Malocclusion is when you have some problems in the positioning of your teeth. Like for example, if there's spacing which is present between your teeth, or if your teeth are overly crowded, or it can be like if your front teeth are more forwardly placed, so that makes your looks like it makes it unaesthetic. And most of the people, they are getting their ortho treatment done just because they want their smile to be like, they should smile pleasantly, like aesthetically pleasant. So orthodontics, so before knowing anything in depth about orthodontics, I'm going to first brief you about orthodontics, like what actually it is, and if you don't get the ortho treatment done, so what are the consequences of this if you don't get it done in the long run. So then I'm going to talk about the aims and scope of the orthodontic treatment, like why are you getting your ortho treatment done. Then I'm going to talk, and this aims and objectives of orthodontic treatment is nothing but Jackson's triad as it is given in textbook. So getting into the first part of the video, that is the definition. Now I'm going to read this definition out for you first. Now ortho in Greek means to correct. Odontos is nothing but tooth, and is science. So orthodontics, it is broken off into three parts: ortho, odontos, and is. So it is the study of the positioning of the teeth, like positioning to correct the position of the teeth. So according to the definition, this definition, it was given in 1922 by British Society for the study of orthodontics. So according to definition, it says it includes the study of the growth and development of the jaws and the face particularly, and the body generally, as influencing the position of the teeth, the study of the action and reaction of the internal and external influences on the development, and the prevention and correction of the arrested and perverted development. So it's a very big definition to mug it up. So rather than mugging it up, I'm going to break this definition into some parts so that it is easy to understand. So first, moving on with the first part. So the first part is, it includes the study of the growth and development of the jaws. So orthodontics is nothing but we are studying the growth and the development of the jaws. Like how our jaws develop. Now we have maxilla and mandible, the bones into which our tooth are placed. So we are going to study how they grow, and we have studied this in our first year in the embryology, about the development of our face, development of our jaws, how maxilla and mandible are developed. So we are going to study the growth and development of the jaws in orthodontics too. So my further videos will say about this, and the face particularly. So now particularly you're studying only the face, as it is related to your teeth. So you are mostly studying your face and the jaws and the body generally, and it influences the position of the teeth. So your growth and development, it gets influenced by the position of the teeth. So the first part, it says you are studying the growth and the development of the jaws and the face and the body generally, as influencing the position of the teeth. So your positioning, ortho means you're studying the position of the teeth. Like every treatment, it is related to the positioning of the teeth. Then second part is the study of the action and the reaction of the internal and external influences. So we have studied in our physics during our school time, as Newton said, there is equal and opposite reaction. There was Newton's third law, which states that every action has equal and opposite reaction. So exactly it's the same. Like we are going to study the action and the reaction of the internal. Internal is our development processes, and external is from outside. Like if you are not taking proper care of your dentition, then the external and the internal influences which are getting on the development. So what are the influences? internally is the development, if there is any problem with the internal development and its action and reaction on by the external influences. And the last part is, and the prevention and correction of arrested. So it is possible to prevent malocclusion. Like, firstly, before in ancient time, people wasn't much aware about the malocclusions. But nowadays, what has happened, now we can prevent malocclusions. Like, there are many procedures of prevention. Like, if we get to know that this child is going to get malocclusion when he grow up, so we can prevent it rather than just giving him whole of that 2 years or whatever the correction process. So we can prevent it rather than correcting it. That is, as it is said, prevention is better than cure. And if that person has grew up, and now after that, if the person grows up, so his development it gets arrested. So over that time, we just have to correct whatever his development is arrested. So this is definition which is given by the British Society. So moving on towards the next part, that is the unfavorable consequences of malocclusion. As I said, what are the unfavorable consequences? If you're not going to get your malocclusions, the positioning of the teeth corrected, so what it will lead to? So any deviation from normal occlusion and appearance is malocclusion. Like, normal occlusion is you can bite your teeth properly. So any deviation from that is malocclusion. So there are four consequences. First is interference with the normal growth pattern. Second is the psychosocial problems, insufficient oral functions, and last is susceptibility to caries and periodontal disease. So what is psychosocial well-being? When your teeth aren't in proper position, so what happens, it is the person is socially handicapped. The person cannot smile freely. He feels shame while talking, while laughing, while smiling. So he feels that he cannot interact with people outside. So he feels that he's socially handicapped. So for example, if any patient or any person for that matter has well aligned teeth, he carries a positive attitude and a positive status. So he have that confidence in himself that he can talk properly. Like, people are not judging you looking at your teeth, because on your face, even though you're not a dentist, people are going to look at your teeth directly, because when you are talking, people are going to look on you. They will look like how your smile is, how your teeth are. If you have if you have any problems in the positioning of the teeth, like if they are too forwardly placed, then that person is going to tell you. Then the dentofacial anomalies and severe malocclusion, they have negative effect on self-esteem. As I said, that person, on the other hand, if he has well-aligned teeth, he is confident about his looks. But on the other side, if he has any malocclusions, severe malocclusions, like there is crowding, then there are some supernumerary teeth, like more extra teeth, then that person has a negative effect on his self-esteem. He feels like he's handicapped. He cannot talk properly, and therefore he's shameful about everything. Then this is the first reason. Main reason is aesthetic, why people are getting their ortho treatment done, because they want to look good. They want their smile, the best smile. And because of this, nowadays veneers are in trend. Nowadays people are more aware about everything, and they are getting their ortho treatment done at an earlier stage. So the second is oral function. Now, how oral function is affected by malocclusion. So there are six subdivisions. There is masticatory function, speech, abnormal deglutition, abnormal muscle function, temporomandibular joint dysfunction syndrome, and tooth infection. So how does your masticatory function is hampered? So for example, as I have shown in this picture, this person is having anterior overbite, open bite. No, this is anterior overjet. There is increase in the overjet. Like, your forward teeth are more proclined. So because of that, what happens, the person, like our anterior front teeth, they helps in biting, and a posterior teeth, the wisdom teeth, those bigger teeth, they are present, molars and everything, the bigger teeth, they help in chewing. So our front teeth, they help in incising or biting the food. For example, if a person is having such teeth, front teeth are like more forwardly placed. So because of that, that person cannot bite or chew the thing properly. So there is masticatory function problem. Then speech. Now teeth are important in your speech. If there is any problem in the positioning of the teeth, then the speech is going to get hampered. Now abnormal deglutition. Because of teeth, you can chew your food, and because of that, the bolus is formed, as you have studied this in, physiology. Yeah, physiology, we have studied about the deglutition process, like how the bolus is formed and how it goes through the esophagus and everything. Esophagus, then we have all those mechanisms about that contraction, relaxation, and everything. So firstly, if you cannot chew your food properly because of malocclusion, then obviously you can't swallow your food, because you need to form that bolus properly. Then abnormal muscle function. Now your like whole mouth, it is covered by muscles, like whole body is covered by muscles. So if you're having any malocclusion problem, then you will definitely have abnormal muscle functions. So the functions of your muscles will also be hampered. Like there will be an excessive muscle, like any muscle will have more excessive function or like decreased function because of teeth. Then temporomandibular joint. Now what is temporomandibular joint? This is the temporomandibular joint. As I said, this is mandible, like the jaws. Mandible this is, and this is maxilla. So mandible, it is the movable joint. And maxilla, it is fixed joint. So movable joint, it is possible because of your temporomandibular joint. If you are going to place your finger in front of the ear, so, and if you are going to open and close your mouth, and if you feel any pain over there, so that means there is temporomandibular joint dysfunction. Like there are problems with your temporomandibular joint, and this happens only when you are having malocclusions. Like if your occlusion isn't proper, so this will finally lead to this TMJ, so the temporomandibular joint dysfunction syndrome, because of which there is pain over there. So patient cannot open their mouth properly. There is tremendous pain over the temporomandibular joint. Then last one is tooth impaction. Now what is tooth impaction? As many people are getting the surgical treatment done over the wisdom teeth, because nowadays what happens, they are not having like more space to get their wisdom tooth erupt in their mouth, because of which what happens, they get impacted, they get into the jaws itself, so they are not coming out. So that is tooth impaction. And if you are having malocclusion, so because of that what happens, your tooth doesn't get erupted out in the oral cavity, and there is tooth impaction. So tooth impaction is nothing but unerupted teeth. So they can be, because of this unerupted teeth, there is formation of cyst, dentigerous cyst, as it is said in oral pathology. We have studied that dentigerous cyst is associated with impacted tooth. So there is more chances of the formation of dentigerous cyst than there is unerupted impacted. And it can also lead to supernumerary teeth. Supernumerary teeth is when you have more teeth, like extra teeth. So after that, you're getting them extracted for, because if you have more teeth, like supernumerary teeth, and your wisdom teeth are going to erupt after the age of 17 to 25 or 22, most people, they get the teeth erupted at that time only, wisdom teeth. So if you have supernumerary teeth in your jaw, in your mouth, so because of that, what happens, this supernumerary teeth, it leads the impaction of the third molars, that is the wisdom teeth. Then relationship to injury and dental disease. Now injury and dental disease, like trauma to your anterior teeth, periodontal disease and caries. Now what is trauma to anterior teeth? Now trauma to anterior teeth is when you have been the risk of trauma, like to the anterior teeth. If your anterior teeth, the upper front teeth, they are more proclined, like they are more forwardly placed. So because of that, what happens? So they are more prone to trauma. Trauma is like if you fall, that teeth falls off, like there are more chances to get hurt over there if there is malocclusion anteriorly. So now caries is if there is malocclusion, you cannot clean your teeth properly. Because of this, there is more risk of caries. And periodontal disease, again, you cannot clean your teeth. So because of that, there is plaque accumulation. Plaque accumulation it finally leads to periodontitis and gingivitis. As I have said everything about periodontal disease, like I have started my periodontal disease first topic, there is gingival recession in my last video. So please go through it to know actually what periodontal disease is, like the sequence. Then moving on towards our next, that is aims of orthodontic treatment. So it was given by Jackson. Like, what are the objective and aims? Why are you getting a treatment done, ortho treatment done? So there are main three objectives, main three aims, and it was given by Jackson's, and hence it is known as Jackson's triad, because there are three things. Triad is three. So first of all, the treatment provided should not only satisfy patient's aesthetic desire. As I said, the patients, mostly they are coming to get their ortho treatment done just because of aesthetics. They want to look good. But as it is said, when we are doing our ortho treatment, so the dentist should see all these three elements, like the functional efficiency, structural balance, and aesthetic harmony. Aesthetic harmony, everyone, even the patient knows what is aesthetic harmony. Like, they are main getting the treatment done just because of that only. So the orthodontist, he has to pay attention to all these three factors: aesthetics, what the patient is desiring, then the functional and the structural. Now functional is like, if you're getting your ortho treatment done, so it's like, just for the sake of aesthetic, we can't place your teeth in that manner that they are functionally disabled. Like, you, the main function of the teeth is to chew. So if we are getting a treatment done and if we can't chew only properly, then what's the use of getting the treatment done? So first is functional efficiency. Like, the form and the functional, they are interrelated. Any malocclusion may adversely affect normal functions. One of the main aim to improve functional efficiency of the somatogenetic system. So when we are getting a treatment done, we have to look into functional efficiency also, that the function of the teeth, what the actual function of the teeth is. So it should also be kept in mind. Then second is structural balance. Then ortho treatment not only brings about changes in the dentition, so, but it also brings about changes in the surrounding soft tissue envelope and associated structures of the bones and the TMJ. The treatment should balance between the structures. Now when you're getting your ortho treatment done, so now your teeth, they are placed in the socket on the jaws. So when you're getting your treatment done, so it has their impact on the jaws also, on the musculature, on the muscles also. So when the treatment is done, we have to keep balance between all the structure. Like, we can't do something good with one thing and we can't like do bad with other. So we have to keep that thing in mind. Like, if we are getting a treatment done, we are emphasizing on everything. Like, we are emphasizing on our dentition, then our stomatogenetic structures, that is the basal bone, the bone, and the TMJ also. We have to pay attention to TMJ also, because it will not give any symptoms in earlier. Like, there are no earlier symptoms, but you will feel all that pain near the TMJ in a longer run if you have that malocclusion. So these are the aims of orthodontic treatment, which was given by Jackson. So it is known as Jackson's triad, and it is a very important question as an exam point of view, as in your exam point of view. The scope of orthodontic treatment. So what happens because of orthodontic treatment? So there are three changes which can happen because of orthodontic treatment, that is orthodontic change, orthopedic change, and altering the soft tissue envelope. As I said, orthodontic change is your positioning of the teeth is changing. Orthopedic is when you have problem with your bones, and the soft tissue envelope is the musculature, soft tissue. Then orthodontic change, most malocclusion, they involve only dental structures, and this change be effectively treated by moving teeth so as to bring them into ideal position. Now what happens is most treatment are done just because they have some problems in the dentition, like the position of the teeth is not proper, and we can get it easily done by getting those braces off. So but what happens in some cases, the jaws are the culprit. Like, there's problem in your jaws and not the teeth, but the positioning of the teeth. Now what happens if the patient is in growing phase? So we can give him certain appliances, functional appliances, which will lead to like whatever the problem is. If the problem is with mandible or maxilla, if the problem is with mandible, then with those functional appliances we are going to correct the position of the mandible rather than your teeth. So, and if the patient has grown up, like after a certain age, like the patient stop growing. So at that time, what we have to do is we are doing orthognathic surgeries. At that time, as we cannot give those functional appliances because it's of no use as the growing phase is over. So at that time, what we are doing is we are giving those orthopedic, so we are doing orthognathic surgeries at that time. So an altering, so malocclusion may result from disproportion between the basal bone. Depending upon the age, it is possible to move entire jaw in position. By orthognathic surgeries, jaw can be brought in position. As I said, like if there's any problem with your positioning of the jaw, then we have to correct it, and that is the orthopedic change. And positioning of the jaws, it can be corrected if it's in growing phase by functional appliances, and if your growth has been completed, then it is corrected by orthognathic surgeries. And I'm going to take orthognathic surgeries in my further videos, and even the functional appliances, everything. Then altering the soft tissue is you're altering the musculature also. So this is the scope of orthodontic treatment. And getting into the last part of the video, now contribution of Edward H. Angle. I have added this portion because it's an important question that is asked frequently in our exams, like what are the contribution of Edward H. Angle. It's mostly asked as a short answer question, so I've added this. So now, who's Edward H. Angle? Now he's known as the father of modern orthodontics. So what are his contribution? Like, he is considered as the father of modern orthodontics because he has brought about many changes in orthodontics. So he was the first person to recognize orthodontics as a separate specialty in the branch of dentistry. So he recognized orthodontics as a specialty because as we have 8 specialties in dentistry too. So he recognized that orthodontics is a specialty. So then in 1900, he started his first school of orthodontics in St. Louis, that is in New London. So he started the first school of orthodontics. So he has recognized that orthodontics is a separate specialty. So in 1900, he started his first school. So he organized a first orthodontic society in 1900, the American Society of Orthodontists, which is now known as American Association of Orthodontists. And he became the first president of that society. So he organized the first orthodontic society. Then he introduced the permanent first molar as a key of occlusion. Now, as you have studied the Angle's classification for occlusion, so malocclusion, so in that he has stated that your first molar, they are the key of occlusion. Permanent first molar, upper first molar, like you're going to keep your upper permanent first molar fixed. And they are the key of occlusion, like they are going to determine how your occlusion is going to be, like whether it is class 1, class 2, class 3. And I'm going to take in brief about all the classifications of malocclusion in my further videos. And in 1887, he presented his classification of malocclusion, that I said the Angle's classification of malocclusion. And it's been more than 100 years that we are still accepting his classification only, like whenever you're going to any clinic or colleges, then they are going to refer to this classification only, Edward Angle's classification. And then he also founded the first orthodontic journal, the American Orthodontist, in 1907, but it could not prolong its publication, so he found his first orthodontic journal. Then he has 37 patents to his name, like he has made so many contributions to orthodontics. Then he had developed many different appliances. Some of them are, in 1900 he gave E-arch. These all are different appliances which are going to bring about changes in your positioning of the teeth. So they are helping you in the treatment. So he has given many appliances. Some of them are, in 1900 he gave E-arch. In 1910 he gave pin and tube appliance, European arch appliance, and edgewise appliance. Edgewise appliances, those brackets, like there are appliances. There are mainly two appliances which everyone uses: Beck's appliance and edgewise appliance. So edgewise appliance was given by Edward H. Angle. And he was the proponent of non-extraction school of thought. He thus advocated arch expansion. Now he always stated that, like nowadays, if there is crowding, so we are advised to extract a tooth. So he was the proponent. Like he thought, like without extraction, all the malocclusions can be corrected. So over that time, he did arch expansion in every patient. Rather than extracting them, he used to expand. He used to expand the jaws, the space between the jaws. He used to expand them rather than extracting them. So all the teeth, they are accommodated in that jaw. So all this are the contributions of Edward H. Angle, and it's an important question. So I have added this in this slide. And this is the end of my video for introduction to orthodontics. So if you have any doubt in this particular topic, you can leave it in the comment section below. And if you have any suggestion on what videos I should do first, then even you can write them down in the suggestions in the comment section. So thank you so much for this video. I hope you find this video helpful and you liked it. So do like, comment, and subscribe to my channel and press that bell icon so that you get notified about my videos that when I'm going to post them and which topics. So thank you so much.